Hello and welcome to the show. I'm Martin Willis, your host, and we got a great show for you this evening. Paul Dean, as you see him up on the screen here on YouTube, and I want to thank you for the people out there that are watching this live. I do appreciate that you are in the room, so to speak, on Facebook and YouTube. And Paul is, he's from Australia. If you haven't heard about him in the past, he's an amazing guy. He focuses deeply on government and military involvement in response to the UFO phenomena. So we'll be talking to him in just a minute, but a couple things first. Again, I want to thank everyone for being here. I want to thank everyone that listens, everyone behind the scenes, and of course, people that support the show. I couldn't do it without you, so I thank you very much. We are simulcast on Facebook. There is a chat room in there and actually shows up on the screen here, which is pretty interesting. So if you go over to podcastufo.com, you'll see our latest blog by Charles Lear. It's called UFOs Over Michigan and the Swamp Gas Explanation. That's the thing that Alan Hynek actually never lived down. So it's a great blog. And as some of you that have this show in your podcast feed, wherever you get your podcast, you'll notice that these audio blogs are going in to the feed about midweek. So Charles, actually, you know, the author of these blogs, actually reads them and sends them to me, and I put them up so you can hear them actually on YouTube as well, putting them there. And no calls tonight, but as usual, I'll try to keep an eye on the chat tonight. And if you want to post a question for our guests, it's probably a good idea if you put it in all caps to make sure that I don't miss it. And you know what? I think that's going to be it for me. And I'm going to bring our guest in right now. Well, welcome to the show, Paul.
Hi, how's it going, Martin?
It's going great. Thank you so much for being with us. And we had to do a little bit of maneuvering, but we got you here.
Yeah, I'm not very good with computers.
No, I meant as far as the date. You know, we're doing the show Sunday night and it's Monday morning. We're in the future. Yeah.
Yeah, so the time zone thing's terrible. Yeah. It's weird. Yeah, it's even harder with the West Coast, actually. It's really hard with the West Coast.
And it's always so strange that your country is going into summer now and we're starting to get the chill here.
Yeah. So. But, it's not cold anymore. It's definitely getting warmer. So
So where in Australia are you exactly?
I'm down southeast, so right down the southeast. So Melbourne, so a bit south of Sydney. Most of Australia's cities are on the east coast, and I'm down the bottom.
Oh wow. Yeah. I mean, Australia's all coastal, basically. I mean, it's a huge population. Island. Yeah.
Yeah. It's all around the coast. It's a bit like, you know, they say that. You know, I think 90% of Canada's population are along the border. Well, in Australia, it's 90% of Australia's population are, you know, just on the coastline. There's virtually nothing in the middle.
Amazing. Amazing. Yeah. And I think there's like 25 million people, something like that. 25.
Yeah, it's 25 million people, and yet we're just only slightly smaller than the continental United States. So it's very, very sparsely populated. And it's one of the most sparsely populated places in the world.
Wow. And one of my top listeners to this show are Australians, which is amazing.
Oh, really?
It's usually the second or third in the when I actually go through and take a look. So there's a lot of fascination with UFOs in Australia. There has to be.
Yeah. And there is. I would say there's a lot of people interested. Maybe not dedicated researchers, but there's a lot of people who I would call them UFO buffs. I mean, they're certainly interested. They're reasonably well read. They've absorbed the right material over the years. I get quite a lot of contact with people like that. But as far as hardcore researchers that really do stuff, there's not many of us, unfortunately. Same thing in New Zealand, very few, one or two. That's it.
How about that?
It's bad for the future of the topic, I guess.
Well, you hear a lot here. Now, there are, you know, I look at also the demographics. There's a lot of young people, 18 to 35, that listen to the show, but you don't see them at you don't see a lot of younger people at conferences. And I'm sure it's probably the same there, right?
I've spoken at conferences, been to conferences. It's a mix, but it's not, most people would be in their 50s or 60s that go to conferences. That's what I've found. I've stood there looking out at the audience and some of them are in wheelchairs. you know, like the, so like the, so, you know, the, into the 80s. So that's also not a good sign. It's either people are doing everything online or still possibly reading books, and there's nothing wrong with that. But as far as, certainly attending conferences, and conferences aren't that big for me. I mean, like when conferences are happening, you know, vast majority of the audience are already true believers, and then half of them would be fairly mentally marginal, if you know what I mean. So yeah, it's not, I don't think conferences actually do much. You know, I don't think they appeal to meteorologists or university professors in the astronomy or atmospheric physics areas or whatever. I've noticed, which is frustrating. It's not like the 70s and 80s where all sorts of people, missile experts, rocket experts, you know, rocket scientists, nuclear engineers would appear at conferences willy-nilly. It's not like that anymore.
Well, you know, last September in Phoenix, I met Ben Hurl.
He's been on the show,
and he was with his whole group there from Victoria,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So that was a lot of fun. Hanging out with those guys.
Yeah, I know them quite well.
Yeah. So can you tell the listening audience how you got involved? You know, what sparked your interest in this field?
Well, there's two things that probably sparked my interest. The first one is my dad. My father was in the army, in the Australian Army. He was with mapping and cartography, surveying. He was actually with the Royal Surveying Regiment, which is Australia's premier mapping, cartography, topology, hydrography entity within the Australian Army. He was assigned for many years to a military base in Victoria, my state, called Pakapanyal. And he's aside from that, he's a very scientific guy. Like, he's a very technically minded guy. And he was back in 1975, so a bit before I was born. Dad was driving from Sydney to Melbourne, which is probably the equivalent, a bit like driving from San Francisco to Los Angeles, like just without the traffic. And
it's 8 hours or so.
About seven, whatever. Yeah. And dad being dad took the short way. Instead of driving just on the highway, he took various back roads, and he was right in the middle of the trip, middle of the night. Unfortunately, a story we hear all the time, this is a single witness case. The witness is fine, but it was just him alone at night as well, which is always, you know, a daylight disc sighting or a daylight UFO sighting is more compelling or tangible than anything at night, in my way, unless you're an astronaut or a pilot or something, might be a bit different. But anyway, dad's driving along, and out in front of him through the trees, we've got all these junky, yucky trees in Australia called eucalypts, and they're sort of these gnarled, undense trees. It's not like looking through conifer forests like you'd find in Oregon or Washington or something. It's you can easily see right through them. Dad saw dad was driving along, you know, 60 miles an hour, a bit faster, and way, way up ahead of him, he saw a perfectly circular light, like a silvery white light, just sort of like, he's driving that way, it's sort of way up ahead of him, and he's thinking it's, you know, it's not car headlights, miles too big, and it's not making much progress, like there's not much, it's not, they're going past each other anytime soon, and he thought it's got to be a train headlight, right? But he's thinking it's pretty high, right? So we're coming up to a hill. Well, the hill never eventuated, but this, he simply witnessed over, we'll say, three, four, five minutes, this spherical or circular light just get higher and higher and higher in the sky. And so he's thinking it's got to be a huge floodlight on a grain silo, maybe, or it's a searchlight on a helicopter. He'd been around helicopters for years, and helicopters just don't hover and just aim a searchlight just ahead. I mean, there's flickering and moving around. Anyway, the ultimate test was he turned his engine off, put it into neutral, and so there's no noise. So he wound his window down. So all he's got is the noise of a tire, like tires going along the road and a bit of wind. And he puts his ear out the window, and he's expecting to hear the helicopters. nothing happens, right? There's no noise at all. So that spooks him a bit. Anyway, the things above him now, it's definitely airborne, right? And he couldn't do much. He didn't stop. He was pretty sure it wasn't a plane with a searchlight or a helicopter. He was sure of that. So he just had to keep going, driving. And a few minutes later, he was of the assumption that it was behind him. And just as he was relaxing, all of a sudden his entire car lit up, like the road lit up. Whatever this thing was, shooting a light at him, right? It's now targeting him. And he said, this is not unusual for my father, but he just completely floored it. Like he just completely, so, you know, 100 miles an hour, 120 miles an hour, as fast as he could go. He was spooked, right? Yeah. So he told us this story. He used to tell us this story. He told me this story when I was, say, 10, 11. The other thing that got me into it is just briefly, and the listeners will probably know this one, off the coast of Melbourne in 1978, October 21st, a pilot went missing. Yes. A pilot by the name of Frederick Valentik.
It was someone already put that in the chat.
Pardon?
Someone already put that in the chat.
Yeah. So yeah. Pilot Frederick Valentik goes missing 7:30, 8 o'clock at night. He goes missing. But what was weird about it was that his last 12 minutes of radio conversation with like flight services unit, air traffic controller, Tullamarine Airport, it was a flight services unit, air traffic controller, Steve Roby. They had this 12-minute conversation, this broken conversation, and it's pretty scary. Yeah. Frederick Valentik describes being followed, harassed, encircled by a silvery metallic object with strange green lights on it. It's all shiny on the outside. And his final words were, Melbourne, that aircraft is hovering on top of me again. It's hovering and it's not an aircraft.
Yes.
Then that's it. There was nothing else ever. Yeah. He was never seen again. The plane was never seen again.
Before we move on from that, I have a question for you. Do you think that original recording exists somewhere? Because I know they did a reenactment.
I know it does. I know for a fact it does. Yeah. It does. I can tell you enough about that. I can tell you, so the actual original recording that was actually at the airport, it's taken, because once you start an accident, back then the Bureau of Air Safety Investigations, Air Accidents Branch, once they start an investigation, the investigation goes for a minimum of 30 days, no matter how uninteresting or solvable it is. What they do, they take the the 1.5-inch reels off the machine. They take it underground the airport to the investigation facility where experts like communications experts and various technical experts analyze the audio. So you've got this huge reel that's taken off. Now that was played over and over and over again for the technical experts, The actual original was put back into service. I know it's all very conspiratorial to say that it was, you know, sequestered away to the, you know, Department of Defense or the DIO, the JIO, who would be the equivalent of your CIA here or whatever. But I do believe that it was actually put back into service and just rewritten over. However, we know for a fact, absolute fact, that the family of the pilot, so Guido Valentik and his wife Alberta, so the parents of the pilot, they were given a copy. They were given a copy by the Victorian and Tasmanian region's manager for air safety as a memento for their son, because their son had died or potentially died and disappeared. So they were given a copy. That copy, they weren't supposed to do this, but a copy was made and given to a US researcher based in Australia called Paul Norman. Paul Norman gave a copy to Dick Haynes. So that's one copy that we know of, or a trail of copies. I also know for a fact, I'm never going to name names, but I know for a fact that two people who worked at Tullamarine Airport also stole copies. So they went in with their own equipment, like an old ghetto blaster with the right like wire cables and stuff, plugged it into the big investigation machine, stole copies. Technically, it's theft. Whatever, it doesn't matter. They took copies home. So we've got three streams of copies. One's legal until it got to Dick Haynes, it gets a bit illegal, and the other two are definitely stolen and unofficial. I know that for a fact.
Wow. But you've never actually heard the original, have you?
I have. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. And is it as scary as it seems like?
No, No, not at all. It's not at all. It's for starters, the first thing that struck me is how unbelievably old it sounds. It doesn't even sound like, I know for a fact that it is real because we've had someone confirm. Well, for starters, Steve Roby, the air traffic controller's voice, is in there. Like, he's doing most of the talking, actually, or half of it anyway. And his voice is exactly like what it is today. Like it's definitely him. There's no question about it. Like, his mannerisms, his slang, his tone, whatever. Now, the other voice, which is, of course, Valentik, who's saying that he's seeing a UFO, right, he's gone. But we've had someone who knew Valentik confirm that he's definitely his voice. There's no question about it. It's not that interesting. Honestly, I listened to it three times, and by the end of it, I was bored. There's nothing.
Really?
It's not scary. The levels of distress are really not that high. It almost sounds like it's from the 50s or 60s. It's really old. Like, it's really dated, and it's actually like he's having a very normal, most of it's just simply like he's having a very normal conversation. Then it might get a little bit heightened towards the end. Then it just stopped. That's it.
How about
it's
when
really not that sensational?
When he says it's not an aircraft.
And it's literally, he just says it like that. He just says, Melbourne, that aircraft is hovering on top of me again. It's hovering and it's not an aircraft. That's it. He's not screaming and yelling and jumping about the place. It's not like that at all.
And is there any audio of any noises or anything like a
contact? At the end of seven.
Yeah.
You might realize that what is weird is that after he says, what happens is after he said those words, Steve Roby, who was the air traffic controller, says, Delta Sierra Juliet, come in, Delta Sierra Juliet, Delta Sierra Juliet. And then, of course, there's nothing. But after that, there's 17 seconds of this weird metallic scraping noise. It almost sounds like someone's got a tin can, like an empty tin can, put a marble in it and spins it around, like spinning around a marble in a tin can like that. It's the weirdest thing. Wow. And I've never heard, I've had air traffic controllers listen to it who were air traffic controlling in the 70s and 80s, and they sort of scratched their heads and they've said, I don't think I've really ever heard anything like this. Like, it could be the plane hitting the water and water getting into the microphone. It could be him making contact with something that's, you know, like whatever aircraft was up there, or UFO or whatever it was. It could be burning like a fire. I just don't know.
Isn't that something, though? Wow.
Yeah, it is weird. What is interesting as well is I've talked to an FAA communications guy, like an expert in federal aviation, like in your country. So the way pilots talk to ground crews with their slang and their technical speech or whatever. And he said to me, he said, look, if he was actually quite skeptical of the entire thing, but he said, look, if a UFO case went down, he said, this is actually how I'd expect it to go. Right, they're not going to say flying saucer and there's little green men hanging out the windows and I'm going to die and all this sort of stuff. He said, this is actually how, his exact words, he said, this is how I would expect it to basically go.
Wow.
So there you go.
Yeah, isn't that something? Wow. Yeah, that is quite a fantastic
So the reason that affected me is because this happened off the coast of Victoria, so it's often in the news, even years later, and the family don't like it. Like, it's brought up on tabloid magazines, and you see it's brought up, it's dragged out every year on October 21st, and it's on, you know, like the equivalent of what you have is 60 Minutes. We've got shows like that. It's on that every now and again, and people are actually pretty sick of it. We're not going to solve it. You know, it's 40 years ago,
and
it's very old.
And it is odd that there was no debris in the water, no oil slick or anything like that.
I never found anything. Marine services. The look, it's a big place, you know. It's not entirely surprising. I mean, we have ships going down that, you know, that are absolutely enormous. We can't even find them. So it's not but it is. Yeah, it is certainly it's part of the story for sure.
But you know, the thing that's different about the ships, well, maybe they do know where a ship is when it goes down, but you know, they knew his path, you know, you know, they kind of knew where
you would have think that they would have found something.
Yeah.
I didn't.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just one of those mysteries. There are a lot of mysteries in this, you know, involved in this topic that I don't think we'll ever hear the answer of,
heaps.
You know,
there's heaps. There's absolutely heaps.
Especially Roswell, the king of them. I don't think we'll ever know.
I refuse to. It would take 20 years to study it. The amount of material we've got. I mean, I just rely on everyone else to do it, like Kevin Randell or whatever. Yeah. I'm so over it that, you know,
So as far as you like getting all these great documents, and we're going to be talking about that tonight, what started you doing? I mean, where'd you come up with that idea?
Well, what happened was about, so I'd been studying the topic for, since I was about 13, and I read all the great works, you know, from UFO Controversy in America by David M. Jacobs, or UFOs Yes, when the Where the Condon Committee Went Wrong by Saunders, or like Hynek's two famous books or whatever. I'd read all the right material over and over again, and then the internet came along and I was able to expand a bit. But something that surprised me, what I thought was very important, was something that we lacked a lot in Australia and Australian research, like in contemporary times, was no one really knew, like even Bill Chalker and Keith Basterfield, really, no one in Australia really knew, say this is like, you know, 7, 8 years ago, 9 years ago, no one knew what Australia's policy on UFOs, whether it be stray aircraft, how to physically report a UFO. And no one knew, it's because there's so many organisations that deal with aerospace. So, you know, there's the Royal Australian Air Force at radar level, like 41 Wing. There's Royal Australian Air Force actual flying operations where pilots would see things, maybe. There's the Australian Transport and Safety Bureau that handles air safety. There's Air Services Australia, which run the airports and navigational and communications systems for pilots. And the Royal Australian Navy. There's that many organisations that should have a stake somewhere in the UFO issue. And what I did, I realised that in contemporary times, we didn't even know the terminology they were using. Like I could honestly not find a single reference to, I mean, did the Royal Australian Air Forces say, did their air command, do they call UFOs, do they call them unidentified aerial phenomena, do they call them unknown aircraft? In a radar setting, do they call them a bogey, or do they call them an uncorrelated target, or an unknown object, or a hit, or a unknown traffic? You know, and in visual settings, do people call UFOs stray aircraft, phenomena, drone, whatever? Look, we had no idea. So the first thing I did, I started writing to, I wrote to the Chief of Air, which is a bit like your Chief of Air Force or Secretary of the Air Force, one of the two. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I wrote to our Chief of Air, I wrote to our Chief of Navy, I wrote to the Legal Department at Air Safety Australia, the Australian Safety Transport Bureau, and so on. I sent out many letters to ministers. We call them ministers, you call them congressmen. But I sent many letters, and what was funny was I got so many different answers back. I got different answers from different departments, and I started asking more pointed questions. Like, you know, I started writing back and I started asking very pointed questions like, you know, like if you see an object in controlled airspace, how do you actually handle it as opposed to, say, uncontrolled airspace, like over the ocean near Indonesia or something like that? And I was getting this flurry of information coming back about, well, terminology and phraseology, what they do and don't do, in particular, like a matrix of what they, you know, like if it's in controlled airspace, they give it three chances to land or identify itself. And if it doesn't, they can, when it does land, they can arrest it, whatever. In uncontrolled airspace, they, if it's going away from Australia, they ignore it. If it's coming towards Australia, they monitor it and they put fighter jets on alert. This sort of thing, I learned this over time. But what I also learned, another thing I learned, was with civil pilots, so non-military pilots, there's actually two ways that they can report a UFO, and nobody had done this in Australia. No one had studied this for 30 years. And the two ways are, one, if you want to report a UFO or a balloon that's nearly hit you, or a stray aircraft, or maybe very suspicious contrail, you report it to Air Services Australia, you can report it via an electronically submitted event report, or you can submit to the Australian Transport Safety Bureau, you can submit a UFO report. It's called an accident and incident notification summary. Okay. So there's two ways of reporting UFOs. So the first thing I did, of course, was using the Freedom of Information Act, which is very powerful in Australia, is I went straight to both those agencies and said, I want, you know, 8 years worth of ESA reports or accident investigation summary reports. So yeah, I went to Air Services Australia and ATSB, and I said, I want all ESA reports and notification reports that mention the words UFO, unknown object, unknown flying, or blah, 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 all the keywords, drone, missile, whatever. And it took a while, but sure enough, the documents started pouring out. You know, pilots had reported UFOs in Australian airspace for a long, long, long time. It's just that no one knew about it. Mm. No one in the public knew about it. The media's not that interested. So so that was one thing I did very early on.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a key thing. I mean, that's pretty major if no one's ever done it before, especially.
Yeah, it was good. And something else that happened, which was really suspicious, this really got me, and it happened very early on, because I've been reading about governmental disinformation and cover-up and buck passing, and we've been all reading about this stuff for so long, it's not funny, particularly from the United States. And very, very early on, one of the first questions I'd asked the Royal Australian Air Force, I asked them, do you use the term UFO? And they came back to me and said, we never use the term UFO. We use unidentified traffic, stray aircraft, blah, 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 right? I also wrote very early on to Air Services Australia asking what terminology they used. And again, it wasn't UFO. And here's what was weird. About a year later, I did an FOIA request that didn't particularly go anywhere. But, I mean, I've done many FOIA requests, but the one I'm talking about, wasn't particularly that interesting. But what I did do is I then FOIA'd the FOI. So you FOI your case file. So that will include, so basically I went to them like 6 months later and said, hey, about 8 months ago, 6 months ago, I did an FOI into XYZ. I want my corporate and case file. So that means my original FOI, their final reply, their internal emails, minutes of meetings that they had about my FOI request, memoranda, routing slips, def grams, whatever. And they said, okay, yeah, you can have all our internal correspondence about you. That's basically what they said, fine. So I waited, you know, a few months. And out comes about 59 emails between...
Wow.
Like, but so out come a bunch of emails. And what was weird was in there was an email from a squadron leader, Jody Hatch, to group captain, which is equivalent of colonel, Colonel Barbara Courtney, who was the director of coordination for the whole Royal Australian Air Force. And it said this, it said, "Dear Barb, I've just contacted Air Services Australia on who there handles UFO and UAE reports, and apparently it is the National Operations Centre." And I'm thinking, hold on, 2 years ago or a year ago, Air Services Australia told me that they don't use the term UFO, and Royal Australian Air Force said they don't use the term UFO, and yet here in writing it says, "Dear Barb, I've just contacted Air Services Australia about who handles UFO sightings." So one of the two, either Royal Australian Air Force or Air Services Australia, probably Royal Australian Air Force, they do use the term UFO. I mean, she put it right there in writing. But what was really interesting was straight after the word UFO, it also says, or UAE. So it basically says, "Dear Barb, I've just contacted Air Services Australia about how they or who there handles UFO and UAE sightings." So one, we've got the term UFO, which apparently they don't use. Right, but they do use it now, we find. And two, what's this UAE? And I never got to the bottom of the second issue. I've asked and asked and asked, what is a UAE? The only thing I can think of is something like unidentified aerial event or something like that.
I was trying to figure it out too. Wow.
Yeah, unidentified airborne event. The E is probably event. The U is probably typically unidentified or unknown or unusual maybe. But never got to the, I asked and I asked and I asked, and I can't even remember how that went down. I might have to actually revisit that. But what was weird, and then to top it off, so this is basically defense saying to defense, like defense department saying to someone else in defense department, you know, contacted Air Services Australia to work out who handles UFO and UAE sightings. And then it says, I found out that it was the National Operations Center for Air Services Australia. So then I find out that it's the National Operations Centre. It's actually in Brisbane, I think. that handles UFO sightings. Yet another thing we didn't know. I mean, Air Services Australia had told Keith Basterfield in about 1999 or 2000 that they do not handle UFO sightings, which you find absolutely ridiculous because UFO, of course, the key part of it, I mean, it could be drones or stray research balloons or whatever. Of course someone fucking handles it, right? Yeah. Like, they have to. They haven't got a choice. No modern air civil safety authority, right, it cannot handle some level of UFO sightings. So Keith knew that that was basically wrong, but to actually see it there in writing that the National Operations Centre handles UFO sightings by pilots was interesting, you know?
How about that? Wow. I wonder if they use, you know, UAP is what you hear in this country a lot, yeah. You know.
And Britain, yeah.
Yeah. But, the UFO term cost me, I'm trying to think who was Dr. Richard
Haynes?
Haynes.
Yeah, Dick Haynes, yeah.
He said, you know, I'd love to be on your show, but he says, I can't be on any show that has the word UFO in the title. He was serious.
Yeah. He's pretty cynical now. Like, I know him.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's pretty over it. Like, I could see him saying that. I could picture that.
Yeah. Yeah. He retired now, but still a really nice gentleman. I really enjoyed some talks with him. He's a great guy. But yeah,
he's donated his archive. Actually, they're sorting it out. He will have, I mean, he ran his NARCAP organization, and he generated a good 1,000 or 2,000 major, or at least interesting airliner and pilot cases.
Oh yeah,
a lot of civilian ones, which is good, and a lot of international stuff. You know,
yeah. You know, I mean, there's so many. You know, you mentioned in Australia, you know, pilots were having encounters, and you uncovered that, but there's probably many, many, many that we don't even know about. We'll never know about. I had a friend that I hadn't seen in many years. He was on the show just to say hello and talk about a UFO sighting he had. And then he talked about his father was a pilot, and his father's friend that had a UFO sighting. You know, of course that was never reported. It was, they didn't want to report it.
Yeah.
You know,
there's actually a totally, there's a totally untapped resource. If people want pilot sightings, there's one untapped resource which is going to be fantastic. The problem is there's no way to compel the reports or the investigations to ever come out. And it's so simple when you think about it, right? But people don't think about this. Thank you. It's just the airlines themselves, right? Like if you went to the biggest airlines in the world, you know, Continental, Qantas, British Airways, right? I mean, most pilots aren't going to report even to their airline, but some do. There's always a percentage, you know, it might be 5% do. You know, they might say, well, I don't want to report it officially through this channel or this channel or this channel, but I do want to tell the operations manager at my airline, or they might get compelled to. It might be the passengers ring British Airways or Continental or UA or whatever and say, look, we're on a plane, you know, like we were on one of your flights like, you know, 2 days ago and we saw this UFO or whatever out the window and the pilot didn't even bother deviating, whatever. And eventually I'm thinking that the airline would get in contact with the pilot of that flight and say, look, did you see anything up there? Because we're getting stories from the crew and what. And I'm thinking that, I mean, I do know for a fact that, now who was it? I think it was one of the airlines what would be an airline that's for Florida? Southwest or something?
Well, if Southwest does go, that so does JetBlue. There's, you know, all the major airlines go to Florida.
I'm thinking, I remember vaguely reading that in the 90s, that I think it was Southwest had literally a repository of UFO sightings that were by pilots, like by their pilots. And it makes sense, you know, if 1% of 1% of pilots see a UFO for Southwest Airlines when they're flying in the United States, right, that's still going to amount to 200 or 500 sightings that are tallied up. Now, a lot of them won't be investigated. There's no point. There's no money in it, right? There's no but that is, I mean, you think about the number of airlines in the world that have been around forever. I mean, you couldn't even count them. Like, there must be thousands and thousands of reports, but you can't compel them to release them because they're private companies, so they're not subject to the FOI Act or anything else. I mean, they can just tell you to go away. Like, they'll just lie and just say, well, we don't have any, we destroyed them, it's of no interest to us, and, you know, it's embarrassing and whatever else. They're not going to release them. They don't have to. Unless a judge pushed them, maybe then, but yeah.
Well, you know, I think of, you know, right off the bat, it comes to mind for me as United Airlines on the O'Hare incident, gate C-17, 2006, you know, because that was just completely swept under the rug. They couldn't talk about, no one could talk about it.
Yeah, I know. So, I know, it was bad. I think that was a very, that was a panic case. I mean, that the lid went down on that pretty badly. Like, yeah. I've never really studied it. I've read bits and pieces. I mean, I've seen, you know, I've read it a bit, but there's definitely more avenues for research. That'll be something that in 10 years' time or whatever will all explode open, and a whole bunch of pilots and ground crew who are well
retired.
Retired, get together, and they'll say, well, this is actually what happened. You might find it's not as explosive as what, you know, I take a lot of things with a grain of salt. You know, they say that the object was this big, and then you find out it was actually that big, or you find out there was a hole through the cloud that you could see for 10 minutes, and really it was like 30 seconds. So, but something happened. There's no question there was there's a case there to be solved, or not, you know, no doubt.
Yeah. I mean, you know, the thing that was so, you know, amazing about it, it's I've been there many times. I go to Chicago quite a bit, usually. I haven't in the last year or two, but still, that airport is super, super busy. So much traffic there. And, you know, whatever it was a threat of, you know, threatening.
Air safety, if nothing else.
Yeah, air safety.
Fancy having fancy of all the places that you could, I mean, like, it incredibly dangerous and so distracting. Even if we find out it actually, like, whatever it was, like, it you couldn't pick anything worse. It's bigger than JFK. Like, it's so, I've never been there, but I've heard, you know, I know people live in Chicago, and they said this, you can't believe how big this airport is.
It is. Yeah. Wow. So now you've gotten into all kinds of, not just Australian documents. You've reached out all over the place, right?
Yeah. I mean, like, I saw all these avenues. Like, I wanted to do work that nobody else had ever done, or that people had, or researchers had attempted to do, but never gotten very far, or had given up, or whatever. And you think logically. I thought logically about this many years ago. And like, if you think about it logically, right? The organizations, we'll take the United States as a good example, and it's probably the best example. The organizations, this is what frustrated me, the very organizations that are responsible, or were in the past responsible for two things: atmospheric detection, so air sovereignty, air safety management, the detection and tracking of objects in the atmosphere, right? So that's Federal Aviation Administration's en route system, the radar approach control radars with the Federal Aviation Administration, then the long range air defense radars run by the United States Air Force at squadron and wing level, often for NORAD, North American Aerospace Defense Command. Then get into space detection and space surveillance. So that's run by Air Force Space Command, Naval Space Command, or what used to be Naval Space Command. Particularly Air Force Space Command's 21st Space Wing, the Missile Warning Center as part of NORAD and US Strategic Command, formerly US Space Command back in the 80s. And it just hit me that everyone is banging on constantly about the FBI and the CIA and NASA, right? It's always NASA, right? Like, nobody's got, other than a whole bunch of fact sheets and a whole bunch of, like, internal papers and buck passing, I think NASA's a big, like, it's a big red herring. Like, there's nothing there. There is no secret cover-up with NASA. I think people have been, I mean, the NASA and the CIA and the FBI seep into people's UFO government cover-up conscience like a poison dye, right, is a total waste of time. Like, the very organizations that actually do detect and do track space objects or atmospheric objects, which are highly unusual, keep the data, analyze the data. We know that for a fact, or I do. I've found the documents, right? They're the very organizations that no one, it's all put in the too hard basket, you know? Like, it does get very complicated, you know? Like, Air Force Space Command's, you know, where in Air Force Space Command, where do they track objects and how, you know, and you've got to start studying long range radar systems and geo, like ground electro optical surveillance system telescopes. And you've got to really study about how systems work, like long range radar, military telescopes, en route toolkits for the FAA, ballistic missile early warning radar systems that are networked into fusion centers at Vandenberg Air Force Base or Peterson Air Force Base or Cheyenne Mountain or the National Military Command Center within the organization of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, whatever. You've got to spend years studying this stuff. And wow. Nobody, very, very few people do it, you know, like most yeah. of, yeah. And so I slowly learned the history of atmospheric detection, so objects in the air, over continental United States and beyond, and I learned the history of space surveillance that the United States government has embarked on, usually through the US Air Force, and I've had to learn it off the heart, and it's really hard, and that's when I've been able to start finding clues.
Wow. Yeah,
that's what I've done.
That's amazing, and you know, and there's a question I'm going to pull up here in chat in just a second, but one thing I've wondered is, I know they track space junk, and there's like so much space junk up there. But if they track space, if they have that capability, you know, it just makes me wonder, are they actually seeing, I mean, is a UFO coming in from out there and they're seeing that too?
Or rising up or something, they have to be. I know a lot about this, and the actual organization, so there's multiple organizations that track stuff in space, right? Hmm. There's the blah 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 blah. Just give me a sec. So the premier organization is the 21st Space Wing, which is subordinate to Air Force Space Command, which is subordinate to the Chief of Air, right? Like it's a major command, right? Anyway, 21st Space Wing. They run the biggest space detection and surveillance systems in the world. So there is the ground electro-optical surveillance system, which is made up of four telescopes that look out into space and watch everything that's moving. Then there is the ballistic missile early warning system, which looks for missiles, submarine-launched ballistic missiles and land-launched ballistic missiles, but also has a secondary role of simply looking at orbiting space objects. There is the PAVE pause system that looks at either east and west of the United States. There is the Eglin radar system that looks over Cuba. It's dedicated, again, to high atmospheric detection, so missile warheads, high-flying aircraft, meteorites, and then also has a simple space surveillance role of watching everything that goes around. I've studied this so heavily, and what amazes me, absolutely baffles me, something I've learned, and it's required the Freedom of Information Acting of many documents. What's shocked me the most is how unbelievably advanced the technology was way back. Like, I'm talking the 50s.
Really?
Like, I've got documents. I can read one in a minute. I've got a document, for instance, from 1980, which is what, nearly 40 years? It's 40 years ago.
Yeah, 40 years.
And I could not believe what and it was the Eglin site. It was the Eglin, S-band, it was the Eglin radar that looks south over Brazil and, you know, the Caribbean. And they can actually, I'll read it after, but they had the capability with 1970s technology. It was the 20th missile warning squadron with the Eglin, massive Eglin radar system. It's like a huge pyramid on its side sort of thing. They actually had the capability in 1980, and remember, this will be 60s and 70s technology with maybe late 1970s software. They had the capability of looking at an object 200 miles away into space, right, or at least sort of on the horizon towards space. They could look at an object for a few seconds. They could measure its width, its height, its radar cross-section, like how reflective it is and potentially how big it is. They could measure its, like, exact orbital velocity, like velocity. They could calculate any deviations it made, right? This is 1970s technology. Like, I've got another, it's unreal. I've got another document from 1960 where it actually says that with the ballistic missile early warning system, which is a tri-site based in Greenland, Alaska, and England, right, even in 1960, or by 1960, they had already done analytical studies on what missiles look like on a radar, on their radar screen, what meteorites look like on their radar screen, what orbiting satellites would look like on their radar screen. They'd already done these parameters and projections of what different space objects should look like to the user and what different space objects should say to the computer systems. Like the radar's data will the computer system will analyze radar data and immediately tell the user, who's the guy with, you know, the headphones and the alert buttons, will say, right, we've got a missile, or it's just Sputnik going around again, or it's a flock of geese, whatever. It actually had that in the 50s. No joke. Yeah. So now what happens is, to answer your question, what happens is when either the ultra long range radar fence or say the ground electro optical space surveillance system, when they pick up an object that's going past or flying in space or at least very high atmosphere, what happens is this: they, within, you know, half a second, it's matched. They try and match it to an existing object. It's already tagged. So if it's a piece of space debris that's just going round and round and round and round and round the Earth, and it's been going round since forever, right, it'll be immediately matched. Like, they actually expect it to come round. Like, the telescope, the military telescope in Hawaii, is expecting a piece of space debris to come past. 3, 2, 1. Yep, there it is. It's already been tagged as object number 90627X2 or whatever, right? And they see 40,000 of these a day, right? It's just a constant stream of known objects, right? Mm-hmm. If an object appears that's not in the computer database, it's immediately tagged a UO, unknown object. Then the computers go into overdrive and they alert the user, which would be like kind of like a space air traffic controller or a technical guy. They alert him or her. And they say, right, we've got a UO, right? It's an unknown object, right? And the computers really go into overdrive and they work out how fast it's going, its orbital parameters. They use like Kepler's law and Newtonian dynamics, and they work out, you know, the computers work out how bright the object is, like how reflective it is, and so on. And if the computers decide that it looks threatening, so what they call an NFL, NFL, new foreign launch, like it could be a new military satellite, could be a missile, it could be a stray missile, it could be unlikely, but it could be an enormous meteorite. If a UO is considered threatening, like coming towards a friendly nation or the United States, or if it's coming downwards, or if it's got the parameters of a cone-like missile warhead or whatever, it's called a critical UCT, or critical uncorrelated target. That's how it's tagged in the system. If it's not particularly threatening, maybe very small, it's considered a significant uncorrelated target. There's also something called a false uncorrelated target, which is like a computer glitch. It could be a test or something. The point is that every single critical UCT or significant UCT is passed on to the next site. So say they see a critical UCT going overhead, they think, oh shit, this could be like a North Korean missile body, or it could be a piece of Russian satellite that's broken up into different pieces and we're just seeing the results of that breakup, right? That site in, say, Hawaii will alert SpaceTrack in Georgia and Texas, and then they'll watch it go overhead, and then they'll alert the system in Spain, and they'll watch it go overhead, and quite quickly they'll work out where this thing's going to land, or if it's going to nick off into space, or if it's breaking up even more. They actually do something called an impact prediction service, so to work out exactly where it's going to land, if it is going to land. So what we're looking for is one of the holy grails, I believe, of ufology, is to get hold of masses of data, like databases and reports into and studies into UCTs, uncorrelated targets. You know, mm-hmm. How many are there? Like, they're always classified secret. So any uncorrelated target data, so that's like orbital parameters and which detection site picked them up first and which detection site picked them up last, whatever. All that's classified minimum secret. We've got that in writing. We've got manuals from US Strategic Command and Air Force Space Command, which specifically say all critical and significant uncorrelated targets are classified at least secret, minimum, right? So the holy grail would be to have reams of data on uncorrelated targets, but even more telling would be any investigations, studies, statistical studies, point papers, bullet point papers, assessments done by commanders. You know, like what happens if there's been a UCT that's, or an uncorrelated target in space that's done, you know, loop-de-loops over Kentucky, and they've watched it, you know, go this way and then back this way, right? And there's been, you know, a 50-page report. That would be gold. Like, that would be incredible.
Yeah.
It's going to be highly classified.
Yeah, highly classified, but for how long? A lot of these classified things are classified for so many years.
Yeah, they go through downgrading. And, I mean, unfortunately, your government has it has become very – I mean, I'm looking – I actually recently – or a couple of years ago, FOIA'd a document. It's the instruction manual. It's the you wouldn't call it instruction manual. You'd call it the governance and guideline instruction for the ballistic missile early warning, US Air Force's ballistic missile early warning system, Site 3, Fylingdales, England. So it's this huge manual. It's this huge booklet. Right, and it's got the longest name. It's like you know, space. Something like UR55-5G1. You know, US Air Force / Royal Air Force ballistic missile early warning system operating manual, Site 3, England, classified S, secret, whatever. Right, it's huge. Anyway, this document. There's multiple versions of it. The first version was published in 1989. The next version was published in 1992. And then there's a 1997 version of the document. So we're still talking a very long time ago. I've asked the British government for a copy because I'm sick of talking to the United States Air Force at the moment. But I've asked Britain for a copy. Even though it's an American document, I've asked Britain for a copy because they run the Fylingdales site in England. I've asked them for a copy. Absolutely not. They pulled, and maybe rightfully so, they pulled national security classification, like national security exemption, international treaties exemption, on and on and on. And this document, interestingly, the only reason we know this document actually exists is because of the work of a British UFO researcher back in the 90s. Some listeners might have heard of a bit of an oddball researcher by the name of Dr. Armin Viktorian. Yeah, a lot of people haven't heard of him, a lot have. Armin Viktorian was an Iranian national that was living in England in the 80s and 90s. He's vanished now. And he submitted a huge number of FOIA requests and very pointed letters to various governments. And he did really well. And he was the one that actually first started studying uncorrelated targets who were being picked up by places like Fylingdales. This is the sort of stuff I work on. And nobody else, very few people do it, you know. There's very few people that study this.
I bet. We're about ready to go into break. We can actually go into now. But before I go in, someone posted this question here, and Stephen, and can you comment on the Knowles family UFO encounter? And I don't know if we have enough time. We only have a minute or so here.
To be honest with you, I don't like it. I can tell you this for a fact. It was wildly exaggerated, right? The media, the witnesses exaggerated, and the media exaggerated it further. That much I can tell you. But it is an interesting case. No question about it.
And
I know that.
Yeah. Well, on the other side, I'm going to have to ask you the details on the other side of the break. Yeah. But anyway, hang in there. We'll be right back in just a minute.
Yep.
All right, welcome back. My guest tonight is Paul Dean. And right before we went into break, we were talking about the Knowles family UFO event. You say it was wildly exaggerated. What is the story of that? Let's just hear what purportedly happened.
Well, the claim, so Australia's a big place. So right over on the other side of the country, there's a city called Perth. Mm-hmm. And when you drive east from Perth, you drive into nothing. Like once you get through a few towns, you're driving for 3 days without seeing a single, you might see the odd town, but it's in the middle of nowhere. It's ridiculous how it's like, it's nothing comparable. Nothing comparable, I don't think. And back in 1988, I can't remember the date. Anyway, it was 1988. A family were driving a car from Perth to Adelaide, which is a 3 day, if you drive really fast, it might be a 2 day drive of nothing. And it was nighttime, and the family, so there was three people. It was either three or four people in the car, all from the same family. I haven't studied it for 20 years, but there was four people in the car, and it was an old car. And they saw up ahead of them, they saw what looked like a bright light. The bright light turned out to be, they claimed, something airborne. It interacted with their vehicle. So the claim was that it pulled their vehicle up, like it physically lifted their car off the road. So the UFO is above them. Mm-hmm. It physically pulled their car up into the air. So, you know, at 60 miles an hour or a bit less. And then it just dumped it, right? Dumped it back on the road. So terrifying if true. Wow. And of course they crashed. I mean, you wouldn't just keep driving. I mean, they came to a screeching halt, I think, and they ended up on the side of the road. They had a blown tire. That much is true. At the same time, the rumor at the time was that there were other witnesses to it, not the actual lifting the car off the ground path, but there were witnesses to UFOs in the area at the time, like that night. Anyway, the family pulled into a town. I think it was Sejuna or something like that. They pulled into a town and they started talking about it, like to petrol station people and something like that. Gas station, I think you call it. It must have been a slow news week because the media got hold of it very quickly. And the media really turned it into a bit of a circus. Oh. And the media were, as usual, really keen to get the salacious details, not anything else. You know, how long had they been driving? Had they been drinking? You know, all this sort of stuff. There was no remotely improper investigation. The vast majority of the press were not in any way interested in studying the actual car. They needed the story that night, right? So that polluted the case a bit. Now, over the years, people have investigated. Well, one thing that did come out was the car was covered in, or parts of the car were covered in a very, very fine dust, like a very fine dust, which isn't unusual in the desert. And one claim by a Victorian researcher by the name of John Ockertel, one claim was that this dust had a radioactive element in it. I think he claimed it was Americanium, which is really rare. I mean, you'll find Americanium in a nuclear reactor, maybe. But that was the claim. Well, it turned out wasn't true. There was three samples of dust taken. John Ockertel's dust apparently contained Americanium, but he wouldn't answer any more questions like who analyzed it, can we see the results, can we see the conclusions, the whatever. The other two samples, apparently nothing unusual, it's just brake dust and desert dust, calcium and so on. Uh-huh. So there's a bunch of those sort of stories where there's all these dead ends where you look at the case and on paper it looks really shocking and good and whatever, but it turns out that in hindsight there was a lot of claims that were made that just don't stack up. You know, there was claims that there was other witnesses. They never came forward. There was claims that what else was there? There was claims that it was seen off the coast, like towards the beach and into the ocean by fishermen. Apparently no such thing happened, or if it did, it was so minor it looked like a star moving around or something like that. We don't know. Like, is it possible? I mean, I'm cynical enough to say, is it possible that the family did actually see a UFO, had a crash, and then embellished the story to the point where their car was actually physically lifted off the ground and chucked back down again. Like, it's a big claim. It's a big claim.
Yeah. There's one, I think it was in New Hampshire, sort of the same claim. There was a young couple and the car was all messed up and everything underneath. But who knows if that story had any validity to it. Now, there was another case where a guy was driving along a highway, something about lights coming, and then maybe later someone died at the same location. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Now, that is strange. Bent headlights case.
Yeah. Can you talk about that one? Because I always always thought that was fascinating.
It was either March or April 1966, my state, so down southeast of the country. The witness's name, I'm just trying to think of his name. I've actually met him. He actually recently passed away. I can't remember the witness's name. It'll come to me. But he was, again, unfortunately, a single witness case, like a lot of these ones are at night in cars. He was driving through fairly windy roads in the countryside, so in rural, you'd call it in the woods. He's driving along, at night, not particularly late. I think it was sort of maybe 9:30 at night. It wasn't 3 in the morning or anything. And he was familiar with the roads. He was familiar enough with his car. And he's driving along on a reasonably long drive. It wasn't a sort of thing around the corner, like driving around the corner like for 1 minute. It was a decent drive. And he sweared black and blue at the time, and all his life he swears this is what happened. Driving along, and on the side of the road, well into the trees and into grass, he said there was almost like a cylindrical UFO, almost like more like an apparition, maybe not necessarily like a fully structured craft, like you'd think with antennas and flames and whatever. He more like something, more like slightly leaning towards more of a phenomena than an actual structured, device, maybe. Again, I haven't studied this for 10 years at least, but what was really bizarre about this case is that he swears black and blue, because normally your headlights point out straight. He says as he's watching this UFO, like just sitting on the ground, but sort of like a pipe, like cylindrical, with it was bright blue, I think. He swears to God that his headlights bent towards it. So imagine you're driving along.
That's what I remember.
Head. So not only are you seeing something you've never seen before, right? Like never seen anything like it in your life. And there should be nothing out there. No floodlights, no farmers, no tractor operating, no fire, no bushfire, wildfire, whatever. Like this was not accountable by any of those things. The way he described it at the time and even before he died and over the years, it hasn't changed. I do believe something definitely happened. It was, again, single witness case. Dr. Hynek would say to us, a single witness case is no case at all, right? This guy, as far as high strangeness in a case, the driver's headlights bend to the side, he says. Yeah. I mean, you wonder, can you even make this stuff up? Like, that's really strange. That's a real physiological, that's like an EMF effect if I've ever seen one.
Yeah.
That's bizarre. It would have been the perfect case if only there was a whole bunch of other witnesses. But what was weird is the very next day, or it might have been, it was either just before this or just after, in exactly the same spot, a car had come off the road and killed the driver. The implication is did that driver who died, did he / she also see the object and scared the hell out of them so much that they actually crashed their car and died? The police, that's the implication. The other thing is, if you go out to the site, and the police did, and various, I think it was the newspaper people, went out to the site where the witness had seen this UFO and his headlights are bending, right? And there's nothing there. Like, there was no burn marks, there was no dead animals, there was no radiological effects, there was no scarred turf, there was no one else, there was no other witnesses. I think other farmers were asked questions, everyone just shrugged their shoulders. So, really weird.
I mentioned this before. I kind of like the weird cases, the ones that would be almost impossible to make up. And this is kind of one of those.
There's a lot. I mean, Socorro, New Mexico is the most famous because you're dealing with quite clearly a device with doors and insignia and appendages and whatever by an incredibly reputable witness. That's got to be solved. If that can be solved either way, like
There, I don't know if you ever heard of the name Ben Moss.
Writer or journal, film guy.
He's been on in a lot of different movies, but anyway, he's with Ray Stanford's help, who actually wrote the first book on Socorro. And the Pentagon, what's that called? Saucer in the.
It's called A Sorcerer in the Pentagon Freezer. What is it? I know all the books off by heart.
Pantry or something.
Pantagon Pantry. Sorcerer. Silent Sorcerer in the Pentagon Pantry or something like that.
Yeah. Anyway, so Ray has helped Ben, you know, along.
I helped Ben. Ben got. Oh. I've got this.
Oh, really? You're helping Ben too.
Yeah, I've got massive case files, and Ben came to me. Well, I think I offered him something, I don't know, a couple of years ago, and I gave him my case files on Socorro. So I've got the researcher Michael Swords' case file on Socorro, which is huge, and Barry Greenwood, the great Boston archivist. No one's got a bigger personal collection of UFO case material and general material than Barry Greenwood. It is absolutely unbelievable. Three rooms completely piled to the ceiling. No, four we're up to now. And he's just, his house is just groaning under the weight, literally. It's bad. It's real bad. And he's getting more stuff arrives every day. But so Barry's file, well, I generated Socorro material, but mine was nothing compared to Michael Swords's and NICAP's and Fran Ridge's and particularly Barry's. So I remember when I gave Ben some material, he was very grateful because there's a lot of stuff in there that's very original, like the very first letters, the very first maps of the area, that sort of thing, you know?
Wow. Wow. So he has written the book. And as far as I know, the book, he sent me the transcript. So I'm going to be reading through that, but I'm going to invite him on and possibly even our next Tuesday show. I'll try to confirm that. But so I know we've taken kind of a jag from a lot of the documents, but I remember when you and I first started talking, you kind of touched on the ballistic missile early warning system, BMEWS. You touched on that a bit, and you went over what would be great if you could actually find those. I forget what you call them, not unidentified, but you what are they
uncorrelated called? Well, when the ballistic missile early warning system, its primary mission, so it's a series of three radar sites, the biggest, most powerful radars in the world. And there's one site in Greenland, there's one site in Alaska, and the third site is on the coast of England. And all of them look essentially above the North Pole. They're looking for Chinese and Russian ballistic missile launches or submarine, like land-based or sea-launched ballistic missiles. That's their primary mission. That's the primary mission of these three sites is missile warning, like early missile warning, early missile detection and warning for North America and Western Europe's defense, right? There's no point. I mean, if you can know that the Soviets or the Russians or the Chinese from their northern launch sites have launched, you know, a salvo of ballistic missiles, and the computers are telling you that they're coming for Canada and America. If you can get, you know, 20 minutes warning on that before they actually start landing, all the better. So that's what these sites do. That's their primary mission. The secondary mission of the ballistic missile early warning system sites is general space surveillance. So their radars are so powerful that they look out into low Earth orbit satellites. So the sites watch satellites and space debris just constantly going round and round and round Earth, and they're looking for new satellites, satellite breakups, the odd meteorite, whatever. And so that's what these sites do. And I realize with their capability and range, like I'm thinking, you know, there's so many systems actually have limitations. Like airports can only see a couple of hundred k's around them radius diameter. Some radar systems only point in a very, very specific direction. Some radar systems are turned off half the time, whatever. But the ballistic missile early warning system at Greenland, Alaska, and England, they are almost just the premier. They should be the premier sites. If UFOs exist, their data would be incredible. And because they can see right out into space, right through the atmosphere into space, they should be able to pick up absolutely everything. Well, I mean, I know back in the 50s that they were able to differentiate between meteorites and missile payloads and early satellites. And this is with 1950 software. So imagine what they can do now, right? It must be a three-dimension they would have. It's highly classified, but their capabilities would be incredible. But here's an interesting story. I started studying, of the three sites, the most interesting to me, of the three ballistic missile early warning sites, the most interesting to me was Fylingdales in England. It's in Yorkshire, North Yorkshire. It looks across the sea towards Denmark and Belgium, whatever. And its capabilities are particularly fearsome. It looks in 360 degrees, so it looks in every direction. But what was interesting was I started reading the historical material on how the actual system worked. Like there's two main computers. There's the radar system itself. It's an electronically a scanned array type radar. It's not a spinning head. And I started learning about some of the terminology that the space surveillance network of which this site is part of uses, whatever. So I decided, because RAF Fylingdales, where the radar system is, it's actually run by the British. It's run by the Royal Air Force. It's actually, I think at the moment, I'm not sure, but until recently, it was run by Fighter Command. So it's a frontline premier early warning site run by the Royal Air Force, but mostly paid for by the United States Air Force. There's obviously United States Air Force servicemen there. It's a totally joint or combined site between the Royal Air Force of England and United States Air Force through the 21st Space Wing at Peterson Air Force Base, Colorado. And I decided I'm not going to waste my time, because dealing with Air Force Space Command, freedom of information requests has become painfully slow and disorganized. Mm. So I thought I'll go straight to the British. Huh. And I've done a lot of successful FOI work with the Ministry of Defense. A lot of it I haven't even published. I've got to get around to it. And anyway, a few years ago, this is really, really interesting. You can read what you want into this. I'm not reading too much, but it's a good laugh. this is really weird. I submitted an FOI request to the British. So I basically gave them some background about what Fylingdales or RAF Fylingdales ballistic missile early warning system, what it actually does, because the FOI officer isn't going to know everything, right? So I wasn't going to mention UFOs. No one's stupid enough to say to the British Ministry of Defence, I want documents, which can mean anything, can mean printout, target printouts, assessments, whatever. I'm not just going to write, I want all documents about UFOs detected by RAF Fylingdales. Thank you very much. No one's going to write that. You're just going to be knocked back immediately. So what I did, I was obviously more careful than that. So what I did, you got to hear this, right? Remember, I never use the word UFO, nor especially not the word extraterrestrial. So I've asked Ministry of Defence for copies of records related to the detection of unknown, unidentified or unsolved objects by RAF Fylingdales. Specifically, I wish to be furnished with copies of actual detections and trackings, which may include electronic forms, electronic reports, automated pictorials, etc., which are created by systems at RAF Fylingdales. The date range, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I got an acknowledgement a few days later, whatever. And this is what was really weird. Remember, I've asked for essentially electronic reports, electronic pictorials, event reports about unknown objects, whatever, right? And this is the reply I got. I have searched our records for the information you have asked for, and I can confirm that the Ministry of Defence holds information in the scope of your request. However, this information relates to matters pertinent to the defence of the United Kingdom and not to so-called extraterrestrial life.
They answered that after that was the reply to what you wrote them?
Yeah, so I've asked them for copies of records related to detection.
They took the jump. Yeah.
They took the jump specifically. I mean, this is when one of the things I asked for was I wish to be furnished with copies of actual detections and trackings, electronic forms, electronic reports, pictorials, blah, blah, blah. And in the first paragraph, in the first sentence, they've said, however, this information relates to matters pertinent to the defense of the United Kingdom and not to so-called extraterrestrial life. That was the most baffling thing. I mean, either they've looked me up as, who is this FOI researcher, or they've maybe or they've just jumped, but it gets better, right? They go on with the administrative stuff about how long, about that there's too much information to give them, blah, blah, blah. I peel it, but anyway. The last sentence is the department has no opinion on the existence. That, remember, this is after I asked for electronic reports, right?
Mm-hmm.
The department has no opinion on the existence or otherwise of extraterrestrial life. While the MOD continues to receive correspondence from members of the public concerning UFO sightings, the MOD does not investigate those, right? It was the biggest jump I have never, like, it was the biggest jump. Anyway, as the FOIA, what actually ended up happening was, we got into a bit of a battle. Like, we went back and forth. I appealed it and carried on. I reduced the scope of my request, so I wasn't asking for, you know, 10 years worth of data. I reduced it to like a year's worth of data. And they basically came back and they said this. I said that the ballistic missile early warning system, computers and radar at Filing Dales, runs 24 hours a day. It's absolute, it detects everything. They said we've got terabytes and terabytes of data coming in every minute and we've got to store it. They said we simply cannot go through looking for specifically what you're actually after. I find it, look, they, I do believe that the scope of it, the amount of information in digital format would be inconceivable, but I don't necessarily believe that they couldn't weed out, say, a day's worth or a week's worth of uncorrelated targets or unusual objects that they've detected in space or the upper atmosphere. I just don't believe that. I use an example that someone once gave me, very important, and I think this a lot. Someone once said to me, if you're ever at knockback for information that you know should be there or that you would at least like to know more about, they said, it was a person in the military said to me, they said, I can guarantee this. If you're a 4-star general or a 3-star general or an admiral of the fleet, you know, someone with a real power broker, if an admiral or a 4-star or a 3-star general walked into the same building and said, right, I want a week's worth of uncorrelated target data from your computers, he said, I guarantee that the captain or the colonel in the room would say, yes, sir, immediately. You'll have it immediately, like that. So they're telling me that, no, there's too much data. We're not going to pull it out for you. It'd take hundreds of hours for us to pull it out for you. Then we've got to redact it all, blah, blah, blah. Some of that might be fair enough. But my contact said to me, he said, if you were a 4-star general and you marched in there and said, I want this, this, and this, they would immediately say, yes, sir.
Like, yeah.
So I'm not buying it. But this battle went on for a long time, and I've given up. I will try again one day. At least they've admitted that they've got reams of data on object identification above the North Pole. That's enough for me to start with.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. And also, when we first started connecting, you said that I should look into NORAD JCC. I'm sorry, J33C. I tried to look it up, and it was something was renamed or something.
Yeah. Oh, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about the Center for Aerospace Analysis. So in all the reading I've done, and it's been incredibly deep reading, like unit histories and command chronologies and very old instructions and even thesis, like military theses and thesis dissertations and stuff from the Air University or the Naval War College or whatever, I've learned that I found the two... Well, we'll say in the last 25 years, two of the most suspicious entities within the North American Aerospace Defense Command, which is based at both Cheyenne Mountain and Peterson Air Force Base, both in Colorado, they're responsible. So NORAD is responsible for Canada and America's military air sovereignty, missile warning to a point. Missile warning's mostly STRATCOM, US STRATCOM in Nebraska, but NORAD's got a customer of missile warning information, but NORAD's responsible for atmospheric and aerospace detection of hijacked aircraft, the monitoring of civilian aircraft in conjunction with the FAA and blah, blah, blah. But within NORAD, NORAD's a huge organization, covers two countries, but within NORAD, the two organizations that in the last 25, 30 years that I've absolutely 100% sure have dealt with the UFO topic, or should have, or at least their paperwork says that they have, there's two. One is, so NORAD's divided into 8 directorates. There's the Directorate of Operations, Directorate of Logistics, Directorate of Intelligence, Directorate of Manpower and Personnel, whatever. One of them is Directorate of Operations, which is abbreviated to J3. Now, within the Directorate of Operations, there's maybe 6 subdirectorates. So 3-1 would be plans and Directorate of Operations / plans and policy. J2 would be Directorate of Operations, Intelligence and Logistics. J3 is the the subdirectorate for, it's called aerospace operations. So what I'm saying is within the Directorate of Operations for NORAD, there's a subdirectorate called aerospace operations. That is divided into many different cells and offices, and one of them is called the Air Management Branch. And I believe I'd have to go right back into it, but the full abbreviation would be NORAD J33-C. That is where unusual aerial activity has been studied in the past for the commander of the Directorate of Operations. So we're talking data regarding, how fast that they can pick up a hijacked aircraft, like how fast can, the airspace management branch of aerospace operations of the Directorate of Operations was heavily involved in the study of the plane routes during September 11 and how quickly the transponders were turned off and blah, 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 right? So that's definitely one organisation. The other one that's probably far more important, and frustratingly, we don't know what it's called now, and they won't give me a straight answer. And I've asked and asked and asked. I even rang NORAD. I was even offered to ring NORAD. Like, they actually said, ring between those hours and you'll speak to Colonel Smith or whatever. Wouldn't come to the phone. There was a massive NORAD exercise going on. They used that as an excuse. Maybe it was true. I don't know. But the organisation is this. So back in the 80s, it was called the Directorate of Aerospace Analysis, and it was a joint directorate between NORAD and the old US Space Command, and it literally abbreviated to NORAD / US Space Command / Directorate for Aerospace Analysis, right? That's fine. Then it was renamed in 1993. It was renamed as the Center for Aerospace Analysis. And again, it was placed within NORAD and US Space Command. In 2004, it was still called the Center for Aerospace Analysis, and it was placed within NORTHCOM, which is Unified Combatant Command, and NORAD headquarters. So now it's called NORTHCOM/NORAD Center for Aerospace Analysis. Then in about 2006, it disappeared. It was renamed, and they won't tell me what it is. The reason this organization is so important is this. There's a NORAD instruction, like a NORAD manual. It's 20 pages. It's the copy I've got's from 1992. It's called NORAD Instruction 10-15, Identification of Air Traffic, right? Mm-hmm. And on page 10, it says, so just for some background, whenever an object is detected above America or around America and Canada, whenever there's an object detected that they don't know what it is, that's in the atmosphere, I'm not talking about space, talking about in the atmosphere, when an object is detected that's not got radio, it's not transponding, it's not going away from the United States, whatever, it's a bit suspicious, it's called a UT, unknown track. If it lasts in the air, if they can't chase it, if it won't land, if it won't talk back via radio or a distress signal, after 5 minutes, so 240 seconds, it's called a NORAD remaining unknown. That means everything they've done to get in contact with this thing, they're getting really worried now. It's been 5 minutes, right? So basically, all unknown tracks and NORAD remaining unknowns, they are all back in the 80s and 90s and into the 2000s, they were all recorded on something called a Form 61. Which is, back then it was a paper form in the 80s, but now, well, and after that it was a digital form. And on a Form 61, you put obviously the captain's name or the colonel's name or whatever at the top, the date, the time, local, the track, like the track strength, like how big of a radar target it is, which direction it was going, azimuth, bearing, heading, all those things. Did you scramble? Like, did you order from this Air Force base or this Air Force base? Did you order a scramble? If so, how many jets? What were they? F-15s, F-16s, whatever. Did you find the object? Did it disappear? Whatever. Right? The Form 61 is two pages of essentially what you would call UFO information. It's like a UFO pro forma for a radar technician at NORAD. Anyway, here's where it's interesting. All Form 61s, once they're filled out, it says in this NORAD instruction that I've got, it says that all Form 61s plus associated data, that will be actual radar hits, all Form 61s and associated data is to be sent to the Center for Aerospace Analysis for further study and investigation. So imagine this, you've got NORAD technicians and battle space operators, every now and again, when they see an unknown track or a NORAD remaining unknown, it's an object, they've got no idea what it is, it's doing very strange things, they fill it out, and sometimes, I think at the end of the day, unless it's, you know, it's started World War III or whatever, but at the end of the day, all the Form 61s from all the NORAD sites around America and Canada, all the Form 61s are loaded into a computer, and they're sent to NORAD headquarters to the Center for Aerospace Analysis for, like I say, further investigation and study. I think it's analysis and study or something. So what you basically, in a nutshell, you've got UFO-y type data and original reports directly from NORAD commanders or deputy commanders and stuff going straight to one office in one building for further analysis. That's incredible. And we've never seen a single Form 61 or any associated data or an associated investigations, analysis, statistical conclusions, nothing. This Center for Aerospace Analysis doesn't even exist anymore, apparently. It's been renamed, so I believe. This could be an absolute goldmine. There could be literally thousands. I would not be surprised. There were dating back to, say, the mid-80s, there could be hundreds or maybe even thousands of essentially what are kind of UFO cases. Now, maybe they're all weather balloons. I don't know. But I think it's gold. I think that could be gold.
Yeah. You know, I'm wondering, this thought just occurred to me. You know, there's Lou Elizondo out there that supposedly, you know, headed the task force for the Pentagon to look into unidentified whatever. That's a source. Wouldn't that be a source that he would have access to?
I've told you, no, because NORAD is a complete closed book. I have asked the right people, had Lou Elizondo or any of his crew or Bigelow's aerospace or whatever, dealt with the organizations that I'm talking about, like NORAD Center for Aerospace Analysis or J33 office or US Space Command, US Air Force Space Command's 21st Space Wing. I've repeatedly asked the right people, or another one is NASIC, the National Air and Space Intelligence Center at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, which is the grown-up version of the Foreign Technology Division that ran Blue Book, right? I do know that there's UFO study going on there too, or has been recently. I've asked the right people and said, did Lou Elizondo and his merry men ever get to talk to either NORAD or any of the NORAD cells or Space Command, 21st Space Wing particularly, or NASIC, whatever? And I'm either getting back no, or we can't tell you, or he tried, or he tried to, whatever. Like, basically, as far as I can tell, those organizations, surprise, surprise, the very organizations that you would first go to, not the DIA, not some sonar system by the Navy, not a pilot's photograph, right? The systems you would first go to are the ones that he went to last or never got to go to at all. Right? It's like NORAD and the US Air Force Space Command get off the hook over and over and over again. It's always the big, bad, mythical CIA and the embassies and NASA and all this. It's all a big red herring. When will ufology learn that the very places like the FAA's Joint Surveillance System and NORAD's Center for Aerospace Analysis or, you know, the 21st Operations Group of the 21st Space Wing, when will people learn that that's where the gold is, if there is any gold to be found? That's where it is. I'm 100% sure. That's just in America. Well, we've got our own gold here, which is proving to be incredibly hard to penetrate. So in Australia, it's called the 41 Wing. It's a Royal Australian Air Force's 41 Wing. And they operate the most advanced over-the-horizon radar system in the world. It's called the Jindalee Over-the-Horizon Radar Network, JORN. And it can see right over Indonesia, Papua New Guinea, Andaman Islands, whatever. It looks north, right? Getting anything out of them is proving, I mean, all I've had is just redacted documents and excuses. But it's extremely hard to get raw data out. It is highly classified. I can see why. But what frustrates me is no one else is trying. In my country, I'm the only one that's trying. It needs a more coordinated approach. It needs pressure from ministers, or in your case, state legislators or congressmen or adjunct generals or whatever. But it's very slow.
Wow. You mentioned our country quite a few times. So we have this study going on. The investigation that's through Congress, I believe it's through Congress with a task force.
Yeah, that's really good.
But that seems like, that would be one of the places, or these places you're mentioning. It seems like there's so much information or so much potential information in these places.
I know there is. I'm sure of it. Added to the fact we've got, the problem is, that task force is fantastic. It's naval-centric, though. It's Navy-centric. Right?
Yeah, and, that's right.
I'm worried that there's going to be like an end date. Like a project has an end date. It just doesn't go forever, yeah. Right? I'm worried that it's going to have a start and end date that's going to be very limited funded. You might find that the funding is like $25,000 and they only No one's talked about the funding, like the actual dollars. What would you rather, $50 million or $25,000, right? Yeah. We might find out that it's actually that the people that actually run it, there'll be like a technical expert, a photographic expert, an interrogation expert, there'll be some sort of intelligence and security guy. You might find that they're spending only half an hour a week on it, or you might find something else happens that's would be really annoying, would be all of a sudden UFO cases, like modern current UFO cases, completely dry up. They've actually got nothing to do. That's my fear. But it's very naval focused, and if they had I'm hoping that they've got the manpower and security clearances to the problem. Something I've learned is that when you're dealing with the organizations I was talking about before, particularly NORAD, right, they're very, very hard to push around. They use very, very NORAD specific systems, like recording systems, databases, computer systems with multiple levels of interoperability just for within NORAD and nowhere else. It's very, very it's very slow, and it amazes me how slow it is. But I'm desperately hoping that the Naval Task Force will be at least able to have sit-down conversations with people from NASIC and NORAD. But we've seen all this before. Blue Book and, congressional questions and NORAD and US Air Force Space Command get off the hook every single time. It amazes me.
Do you think it has anything to do in regards to NORAD, anything to do with the joint Canada-America sovereignty?
Yeah, a lot. It's a binational organization. Unfortunately, big decisions like the sharing of information, big decisions have to go through both the Joint Chiefs of Staff that are ultimately responsible for NORAD's activities and through Canada's parliament. Both have got to be in agreement. I do know a bit about this. It's all about governance and governance and guidelines. And it just seems that about all sorts of things, not just about UFOs or unknown aircraft or whatever, but I've read a lot about NORAD, and it just seems that they're loath to do anything that they don't have to. I mean, even... even paying for their own buildings, it just seems like they push other departments around quite a lot. I've read, particularly around September 11, that was a big one. Getting any data out of them. I mean, they're not even the one problem with NORAD particularly is that NORAD, being a binational organization between Canada and the United States, they're not actually subject to the Freedom of Information Act.
Wow.
They're subject, it's a bit complicated. Oh, this is in writing. I mean, there is a form, there is an instruction that simply says, as a result of the binational relationship NORAD has between the United States and Canada, it has been deemed, I think since 1972 or something, it is deemed that NORAD records are not subject to the provisions of the Freedom of Information Act. The only get out of jail free card with this at all is there is another document that says that NORAD should, so not must, but should follow the spirit of the FOI Act. So it's basically saying when NORAD, if you FOI NORAD, which you actually can do, you have to do it through NORTHCOM, which is a unified combatant command that's linked very heavily with NORAD administratively. Like they use the same buildings and same, you know, like various systems and so on. But if you do FOI NORAD, they can choose to follow the spirit of the FOI Act. Like, yeah, we'll release this, but they absolutely do not have to. And you've got no recourse. You have absolutely, you can't go to your congressman. You can't like kick and scream and sue them and all this sort of stuff. You can. So going to NORAD for FOI requests is really hit and miss. And they do release certain things. They release really mundane stuff like awards and ceremonies, information, propaganda, yeah. Like really mundane stuff. Oh, it's mundane to us. But
how about that? Yeah. You already talked about the 84 radar evaluation squadron?
Oh, that's an interesting one. Robert Powell. It's one of my, on my list of things to do. So the 84th radar evaluation squadron. So obviously the FAA, their radar systems and the software that runs them is extremely similar to the US Air Force's radar systems and software, right? They are interoperable. They have to be, right? And what we've found out is you've probably heard the old adage that it did apply in the past, but you've probably heard that that air traffic control centers keep radar data for 30 days. So say you've got an FAA site, I don't know, it's Albuquerque, right? And it's looking around New Mexico for primary targets and secondary surveillance targets. So transport, so actual physical bodies in the sky that are reflecting of radio waves and also transponder signals, right? And you've got 30 days where it's usually common that you'll see that, certainly in Australia and America, that radar data, like a full radar picture around an airport or an air defense facility or whatever, radar data is kept for 30 days and then it's written over, right? That's all very well for 1970, right? But we're not in 1970 or 1980 anymore. It's the 2020s. And surprise, surprise, that old yarn about keeping radar data for 30 days, it ain't true. Right, it's kept for as long as they damn well want to keep it for. For starters, my first, when I kept seeing that, my first reaction was this isn't right, because my first reaction is I know that air traffic controllers, when they learn, like when they go to school, which is 3 years or whatever, when they go to school, they use simulations. So they actually do keep old radar data picture from airports to train air traffic controllers. So at least some is kept. And then, of course, some radar data is kept for ongoing investigations, statistical studies, looking for radar glitches, software updates, whatever. So the idea that all radar data is thrown out after 30 days, bullshit. So, but then I find out through Robert Powell and to a lesser extent me found out that it turns out that a massive proportion of FAA civil airport radar data is actually streamed. I don't know if it's live or at the end of each week or whatever, but it's actually streamed to this squadron. It's called the 84th Radar Evaluation Squadron. And for a long time, it was at Hill Air Force Base in Utah, but recently it's moved to Langley Airfield in Virginia, I think. Anyway, this 84th Radar Evaluation Squadron, when you go to the limited information, it's probably only got like 80 people at work there. A lot of them would be technicians and payroll people, whatever. I don't know the structure of the squadron, but it turns out that they basically are a squadron that is, if you read about them, they're a squadron that is dedicated to radar performance enhancements, radar technology acquisition, radar software updating for both civil, like the FAA and the Air Force, and radar analysis, glitch solving, at high level training, specialist training, radar investigative training for like search and rescue missions, that sort of thing. So it's no surprise that the FAA are sending Basically, the implication was that, and again, I haven't studied this for a good 4 or 5 years, but the implication was that despite the fact we're constantly told that the FAA and even our Air Services Australia in my country, that this old story, this old doublespeak half truth that they keep radar data for 30 days, bullshit.
Yeah.
So we, and surprise, surprise, we find out that huge reams of it are stored permanently or for a long time at the 84th Radar Evaluation Squadron. And I haven't actually dealt with them directly yet. I've got to talk to them or, you know, FOI them or whatever. I don't even know where I'm going to start. Like, you know, I can't just say to them, oh, I want you to search through, you know, 10 million terabytes of radar data looking for UFOs. They're just, I mean, it's just stupid. Like, they're going to deny, you know, they won't even answer that. But I'm going to have to find something very pointed and very specific with that. Maybe something like any FOI, any reports or final analytical papers, point papers, bullet point papers, assessments on that they've written in the last, you know, year. So that gives them a very short period of time to like to work with. So I'm not saying all documents. I might give them a chance to release any finished product, like final processed reports and basically opinion pieces about unknown objects that appear on radar, because they can't just ask for radar data. Not years worth of radar data. How would they get it to you? Terabytes of it. Right. I can't send it on a CD. It's just really, and how would you play it? Like, this is the problem with radar data. People say, oh, just get the radar data, right? As if, you know, like, well, how are you going to play it, right? It's only playable on the en route toolkit system that the FAA own and paid for, right? Like, you can't just play it on a laptop.
I know, but I've seen somewhere where they printed out something that was on radar. So something could be printed, but I mean, it would only be for
target printouts. You can request target printouts for every unknown object that was up there. They're just reams of information like direction, heading, bearing, azimuth, size of aircraft, name of aircraft, bracket, was it in distress, blah, 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 blah. But you can get that. But even that, you've got to be a technical expert to understand it. There is one way of getting radar data that you can actually play, but they're loath to do it. And I think they've actually stopped doing it now. Robert Powell knows a lot about this, but what you can ask for is, say, radar data from a particular site over an 8-hour, say you think there was a UFO case over, I don't know, Tallahassee, Florida, whatever. You ask for, say, 8 hours of radar data, of primary track radar data from that site that looks, you know, 150 miles around the area into the sky. And then you say, you have to be very specific and quick about this. You say, if possible, can the format be converted into Windows Media Player with Cartesian coordinates, top of the screen for north, bottom of the screen for south? And you've got to say a lot of technical stuff, like the time period. You don't just say 8 hours. You might say, you know, like 1,000 minutes or whatever, or 1,000, you know, there's a way of doing it that's quite specific. And then they have to, I mean, if you appeal, if they said, no, we don't do that, you could appeal it and make them look stupid. But as far as just asking for radar data, very hard to do.
Well, I have to say this. We have a question someone asked quite a while ago. But I want to say that you are a gift to this field of ufology. You really are. The work that you're doing, the dedication, and you're such a bright guy. And you know how to mine this stuff. You know how to, you know, where to go to dig it up. But the question we had quite a while back, and because I can't believe I'm even saying this, but we only have like 7 minutes left of the show. But it just went so fast. Someone wanted to know if you've ever looked into the Westall incident.
Yeah. It's really frustrating. Yeah. I knew this would come up. April 1966, Melbourne, my city. So it actually happened about 10 miles from my house. The story goes that a large number of school children just coming in, finishing first recess, so about, we're talking about 10:15, 10:20 in the morning, large number of school children witness 1, 2, or 3 UFOs in the sky playing a bit of cat and mouse coming towards the ground. Luckily, they called a school teacher who was a school science teacher, actually, and he saw it as well. He saw 2 objects. And then there was then they had to go into class. It was later found that there was burn marks on the ground, blah, blah, blah. That's how the story goes. right? There's an enormous amount of hyperbole here. Like, if you read the current hype story that would get into a tabloid magazine, they will tell you that there was hundreds of witnesses, that there was burn marks all over the ground, like circular landing points, that there was up to five UFOs, that there was a massive government cover-up, that the Americans were involved, that there was radiation, that there was missing people, that the actual true number of witnesses outside the school may be in the thousands. They were all silenced. Cameras were stolen, blah, 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 right?
I did hear about the cameras, yeah.
Half of this stuff definitely did not happen. If you go back to the original story, we're not talking about hundreds of school students here. We're talking about a number, which it's still impressive. It's still a multi-witness sighting, no question about that. The honest answer is we actually don't know how many witnesses there were. There could have been 60, there could have been 12, there could have been 42. We don't know. We can also say that when you hear things like, oh, the science teacher, Andrew Greenwood, saw the UFO, right? It is true, he did see it. But it was so small, the two UFOs were so small, he had to have them pointed out. Like the kids, he said in an interview with, actually, you know, the atmospheric physicist, James McDonald, Dr. James McDonald,
who was the famous, Arizona.
He actually came to Melbourne and he interviewed Andrew Greenwood, who was the science teacher, about a year after it happened. And he interviewed him. And we've got a tape recording of the interview, you can hear it. And Andrew Greenwood does say that he had to have the students actually point out where it was. It's not like it was hovering above their heads, blasting them with radiation and stuff. It was so far away that he had to have it pointed out. Like, then he had to squint. Like, he actually had to squint his eyes to see two UFOs, right? So there's a whole lot of these stories that you can reduce by going back to the original information. Another one is this. James McDonald came to Australia. He interviewed Andrew Greenwood. And he studied the case, like UFO researchers gave him some case material, the original newspaper reports, whatever, right? Only a year later, Dr. James McDonald got up at, you know, the 1968 House Symposium for astronautics and aeronautics, that they had a three-day panel on UFOs.
Yeah.
Right. It was a House Appropriations. It was the 1968 panel on UFOs, and speakers were James McDonald, Harder, whatever else, right? Mm-hmm. And James McDonald spoke for however many hours, and where he got to his section, like he was literally speaking for hours, where he got to his section on multi-witness sightings, where there's many, many people that see UFOs, you've got to remember, he'd only just, like in the last year, he'd just studied Westall and just interviewed a primary witness. To get up in 1968, and talk about, say, the Westall case, you would think it would be a slam dunk. He didn't even mention it. He thought it was that unimportant. Yep. No. He had a section that went for, you know, half an hour where he talked about multi-witness sightings. Didn't even mention it. He could have, even just 10 seconds were, you know, I went to Melbourne and I interviewed a teacher and I blah, 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 blah. 20, 50 school kids saw a UFO or two UFOs. He could have at least done that. Didn't even bother. He found it that unimportant that, you know, so there's a lot of other things about it I don't like. And there's a lot of things, culturally it's important, but there's a lot of things I don't like about it.
Wow, how about that? Wow, never heard that side of it. It's good, you know, I consider you a healthy skeptic, and it's good to hear it's good to hear that part of it. Because you're right. I have to say this, you know, the media can get a hold of things, and, you know, the time goes by, and, you know, who knows what really happened at Roswell, but now there's a parade there. You know, and who knows what that'll end up. So do you like to interact with people? Like, if someone had some information they wanted to get in touch with you, is that something you do actively? And is it just Facebook? I know that's how you and I first connected.
Facebook is one way. My email address is lowercase pj_dean@hotmail.com. That's a good way. Or Facebook, I suppose. Email.
Yeah. Okay. Well, Paul, thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure. And thank you for, you know, being persistent with me so we can get you on the show. And I really do, like I say, you're a gift to this field. And I really do I highly appreciate what you do.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Well, it's been good to be on. I like doing this occasionally.
Yes. All right. You take
care. The time zone thing's hard. All right. See ya. Yeah. Bye.
All right. Bye now. All right, that's it for tonight's show. Thank you so much for listening. And our next week's guest is a mystery guest only because I don't know who it is yet. I had someone that had to reschedule. So I do say this, if you want to go to our website, podcastufo.com, and sign up on our mailing list, it's on the right sidebar. So you can go there and sign up for mailing, so you will find out who is on our show. And it's also on YouTube here. If you just click the subscribe button and the little bell next to it, you'll get notification emails. So thank you so much, everyone. And we'll see you next week. And remember to keep your eyes to the sky.